lucky as we are, you know, on the plains or, you know, where there are fewer people going into education and fewer people, it's not as easy, but for us, we're dedicated to that still, no matter what CDE decides is required.
But you know what, all of this program, you are over highly qualified. Yeah, anybody with a license is the, yeah.
Yeah.
It's just one of those things, if you're alive, no one really explains what it means.
Right, yeah, so it's just so it used to be that to teach in a subject area, you could have the endorsement in that subject area, or you could be highly qualified, which means 24 credit hours, which should really get you the endorsement, but it didn't always. So when we reconfigured our grades, we had some people who took, we were a little bit more lenient. When we went to middle school versus junior high, we were a little bit more lenient because we needed more math teachers, but now we're pretty close on that. But there, and then I think I saw somebody there, yes.
Two questions. One of them is, we speak in three languages already. If I wanted to dabble in another language, what language would it be? And then also, if I didn't want to learn any new languages, would it be wise for me to search up like the schools that actually speak the language that I speak, so that like would it? Will it give me a higher chance of being hired if I search out the school that speaks the language that I speak and stuff?
Well, yeah, I mean, that would definitely. And do you have any French in your background?
No French, okay.
You know, then Spanish, for sure. I mean, there are more Spanish speakers than any other language. If you're going to add a language that, and you're not anywhere close to anything, definitely add Spanish. China, if you can try Chinese, we definitely need Chinese speakers. Korean. So right now, in our district, we currently translate stuff, and this is sort of how I decide what we might need in the future, into Arabic and Korean and Spanish. So that's for us, but in the state of Colorado, I think Mandarin Chinese is more needed, bigger numbers, but that's just us. So, I mean, yeah, if you are all about languages, then, and you learn languages easily, you might as well do one of those. So, yes. Yeah. Well, I mean, I think all of your end point should be a master's degree, but that's just my personal opinion. Right now, we pay teachers who have master's degrees more, a lot more. So, and if that, you know, even if we did change, I'm sure that we would still pay teachers with master's degrees more. Most districts do across the country. Plus, you know, then you get more out of your retirement because you're at a higher salary. So, and plus, we believe in education, right? We believe in teacher ed. That's why we're here. That's why we're here. But yes, but before you start, it doesn't matter. It makes no difference whether you have a master's degree or you don't have a master's degree. We don't hire cheaper teachers or anything like that. There's none of that. And I don't think that's the thing anymore. I know some.
We have two more questions.
Yes.
Okay. Is that something you would recommend, like getting immediately after your bachelor's, or would you recommend getting a few years of experience?
Yeah, especially if you're thinking you might want to be a principal, you need to have some teaching experience anyway, so you might as well. Yes, we'll go there and then there.
Would it be worthwhile picking up minors in other fields like English and history teacher?
Yes, definitely. Yeah, we hire a lot of people, and in fact, I know some, especially middle school principals, who only hire people with two, whenever possible, with two endorsements. So yeah, that would be a great idea. Yeah.
Is it true that you guys kind of look for teachers who are going to continue their education as their teaching, or is that?
Yeah, definitely. And we have lots of opportunities. We have a huge professional development department, so we offer lots of classes. We offer you know, classes in all of the areas that our teachers are evaluated, and all kinds of things too. So, and I think in Adams 12, if you don't have the CLD or the ESL endorsement, they require that you get it within 2 years of their certificate and then make it into an endorsement or something like that. So definitely you need to, yeah, you'll always be learning because you can't renew your license without continuing your education.
Okay.
Okay, and Mr., could you talk a little bit about using on Facebook? Because, that's something that...
This must be your squeaky clean group. Because there haven't been any questions about...
Yeah, the Facebook.
And Facebook,
yeah. Can get you, yeah, into the bake.
Good.
Yeah.
I would say, again, everything that you do from now on is an interview. And we often look up people's Facebook and what's on there. I don't personally do it before I hire anyone, and some of our principals do and some don't. But I would just recommend from now, forever and ever, that you don't put anything on there that you don't want on the front page of the newspaper at all. And that the thing that's really hard about that is that for me, when teachers are in my office because of a parent calling and complaining because they saw their kid's first grade teacher on Facebook with a low-cut shirt or a, you know, in a very provocative outfit or drinking a lot of beer, doing shots or something, it's because of their friends. They posted it and they tagged you or something like that. So if that also goes for your friends, which is, you know, your friends might not be becoming teachers, and so they don't care. They want to do something else that doesn't matter what they're doing right now. But it does for you. So I would say just make sure that there aren't things out there that, you don't want out there on the front page of the paper, because it's possible. And you would be not surprised, I'm sure, because you know how quickly things go. But if a first grader, or even better, if a middle school student got a hold of a teacher, a picture of a teacher doing shots, it would be around the whole school in 30 seconds. It's just the way it is. And they think it's funny, and I bet your principal won't think it's funny. So I would say don't do that. Is that good enough?
Yeah, thank you so much. We appreciate it.
Real. I really hope that from now on you think about it, think about how you are being viewed, and think about when you get to the point you have job interview, what will happen. Okay? Okay, so let's move on to the next one. Okay, so this is what I've just done. Next page. Professional people requirements. Okay. Yeah, I talked about passing the praxis. That's very important. And students majoring in special education must pass an elementary praxis or place text prior to, you know, actually all this kind of thing is in the particular form that, is that right? That you have to sign to pass this checkpoint course. So I don't have to go through detail, but basically all these requirements you have to fulfill. Let's move on to the next page. Candidates may not take extra courses in student teaching without prior approval. Exceptions from elementary and ECE. Coordinators. Okay, so generally speaking, we don't encourage you to take courses in student teaching, because student teaching is really a full-time job, much more than that, okay? That is 4 month job interview, almost like that. You really want to perform your best, you want to show the best of you, and by taking another course, probably your performance will be compromised, so that's very important. We do make exceptions, but the exceptions will be approved only with the support from your program coordinator and professors. All the field experiences and method courses must be successfully completed. Okay, if you know, you have the content area courses, you also have the education courses. All education related courses have to be completed before you start student teaching. Okay, let's continue to the next one. Let me see what that is about. Obtained by program, all the must be related. Okay, I want to talk about the professional disposition qualities. Just move on to the next page. Actually, you have access to this particular rubric, okay? This one you are not going to read because it's too small, but then through the SDE website, you should have access to this rubric. I really want you to look at this, because you will be evaluated according to this rubric, probably a foundation course once, and then we'll start in the field. Your problem teacher or a professor may use this to evaluate you. Professional appearance. You see how I dress up myself today? Okay, because I take you very seriously. That means something.
how you show up in the classroom. When you give a class presentation that day, how you show you really care about this presentation. Okay, you dress differently. Think about it. Very, very important, okay? So there's the professional appearance, attendance. It does not mean you have to be there every day even when you're so sick, but it means you have to tell ahead of time. It does not mean you cannot be late, but you better let people know, okay? That's very important. And professional responsibility, ethical behavior, respect to your response to feedback. Even though you hear something you don't like to hear, how do you respond? How you disagree with in a professional way, okay? Reflective practitioner, collaboration. Collaboration happens at all levels. Start with the group work, how you work with your peers, and then in the school setting. Professional initiative, respect for diversity, student engagement, communication skills, portrays professional competence and confidence. So these are the areas that we look at when you are in the classroom here at UNC, when you are in the field for a practicum, when you are in the classroom for a student teaching. So sometimes you may be a straight A student, and then you are going to be told, I'm sorry, I don't think you're ready to get student teaching. Why? Because of this. Okay? Because teaching is a profession that does not just rely on the knowledge you have. You work with people, human beings, and these human beings are so young, and we have a huge responsibility. Okay, that is very, very important. Okay, let's move on. Professional teacher education program requirements. You must attend all mandatory teacher education orientations, establish and maintain minimum GPA. That's very important. Different programs have different GPA requirements. Elementary, I know, is 3.0. Okay, if you drop below 3.0, you'll have to take some other courses to upgrade your GPA. In some other programs, it really depends on what kind of programs. The GPA is a bit different. You really need to find out from your program advisors. Teacher candidates cannot be placed in a school where they were once students or where they have a close relative attending or working. Actually, before you start applying for student teaching, we'll talk more about this. But for the time being, I'm just telling you this is the general rule. And there are very, very good reasons that we set up all these rules, because in the past, we have former students who got into big trouble because of this. Okay? Let's continue. Fieldwork requirement procedure. All of you will be in the field. This is an integral part of the program. You start being in the field. Secondary, there's a step one, step two, step three, step four. So from year one, you are going to work with the students in the classroom setting in order to get you ready. For elementary candidates, right now is the field component is not strong enough, but then we are going to have a new program next year. If you want, you can switch to the new program. There is much heavier field component. Self-placement requirement, teacher candidates do not arrange placements yourself, okay? You don't do that, we place you. You'll be invited to give us your preferences, but they are only your preferences. There is no guarantee, because there are a lot of factors we have to take into consideration when we place you. Expectations in the field, be professional, seek help and support in a timely fashion, which really means I really want to help you. As I said, I want all of you to get a job after that, to be hired, really, really seriously, okay? And the problem is that I really cannot read into your mind. Okay. I don't know you are struggling. What I'm saying is that if you have an issue, if you're struggling for whatever reason, let us know, tell the professor, talk with your advisors, okay? We can help you. In university, there's the whole structure and system in place for you. Don't wait. Please, I'm begging you not to wait until it is too late, all right? From time to time, I got into this situation with our candidate who said, well, I did not tell you because I didn't want to bother you. But you know what? That's why you are in this kind of situation. And sometimes it's really, really too late. I don't want that to happen. So please let us know when there's the tiny sign of struggle. Okay, talk with your professors. Every one of us, okay, is here to help you. Okay, seriously, yes.
Even if the struggle is not academically, but more.
Yes, exactly. Even not academically. All right? There is system, there is structure in the university to help you. Anything, everything, okay? Even if you have a fight with your mom, that's okay. You can talk with us. We'll give you some ideas. Okay? We'll send you to the people who can help you if I cannot help you. Really, truly, okay? Anything. Anxiety, stress, okay? Fight with your friend, okay? And not wanting to attend class. Tell us. That's okay. I know you are human beings. I want you to get your problems resolved before you get into the field. I want you to have a successful experience here at UNC. Understand? I'm serious, okay? I have a 19-year-old son, okay? Okay, so, you know, I have that kind of, sometimes I have that kind of mother, whatever, I don't know how to say it, but truly, we really want to help you, okay? Don't hide it. You don't have to be the only person to shoulder, you know, all kinds of issues. We're here to help you, okay? So next time if you say, well, I didn't know that I could help, but don't tell me that. I'm telling you right now, you could have asked, okay? By the time I'll say that, if you don't come to me in time. Follow guidance from your professors and or field supervisors. They are great people. They are here for you. Next, how do you handle issues? Oh, this is something you really like, right? Anybody has told you that already or no? Not really? Okay. This is so important, you know. This is, when you have a grade dispute, this has nothing to do with teacher preparation, okay? This is a general college thing, but I found myself being in this situation all the time, telling the student what they're supposed to do. So I'm telling everyone here right now so that you have an easier time. One thing you have to know, it's a little bit different from the way that high school functions, okay, in terms of grades. In higher education, professors are the ultimate people who decide what grades you have earned. Pay attention to the word that I just used. I say you have earned, not you have been given. Okay? The grades are something you have earned through providing evidence of learning. Okay, I'm not saying through attending classes. You don't earn a grade by attending classes. You earn a grade by providing evidence of learning. Read your syllabus of every single course and see how the grade is earned. That's very important. When the university hires a professor, the university has to hire the person that the university believes is the best, the most qualified person in the field of the studies, okay? So the professor should know much better than I do in terms of what grade you should earn from that history class. I'm not an expert. So when you come to see me to say, can you have the grade change? I can't. Nobody can force a professor to change a grade. Not the department chair, not the dean, not the provost, not even a university president. Nobody can do that, okay? There are only two reasons that a grade will be re-examined. One is that when there's the obvious computational error, okay, that is so easy, okay? And I sometimes made that kind of mistake, and a student came to see me and I said, oh, yeah, for sure, thank you so much for letting me know, great change, okay? Another way is when there is a violation of due process, when there's a discrepancy between what the professor said in the syllabus and how the professor actually graded. But then still, it's the professor who has to review everything before it goes out. So my suggestion here, okay? Since the decision is really the professor's decision, it's always a good idea to go to the professor as the first person to talk to. This is only a suggestion from me. You don't have to follow, but as a professor, I've been a professor for so long, okay, almost 20 years, so I understand the mentality. Go to the professor before you get grade. When you struggle with the content, when you are not so sure if I've done a good job for this project, when you go to the professor after you get a grade, you know what that shows? That shows you care about the grade more than learning. Right? Probably when you do a project, you are not so sure, you want to go to a professor for help. That's the best time. Before it's a done deal. All right, so this is one piece of suggestion I'm giving you. And then after the done deal, you go to the professor. Don't use this argument. Don't say, I must train A student. I've always got A, how come I got a B? That's not a good reason for the grade to be changed. Doesn't matter, maybe this is your first B. From now on, you will have a B.